Hey folks, I'm recording this video on top of my head, speaking on top of my head without any preparation. I just want to spend a few minutes to describe different aspects of FG42 and how to start extending FG42 and implement the stuff you might need in FG42 or FG for short. I have a cold, so my voice is funny and I might make some weird noises. Forgive me in advance. And I didn't do any preparation, so I might just talk nonsense. To start working on FG42, the first thing you have to know is eLisp. If you have any experience with any Lispy language, you might find it easy to pick it up, but in general it's another Lisp. It's kind of a really old Lisp. It's quite similar to a Scheme and Common Lisp, but to be fair, it's not the best Lisp implementation, not good. Like, it's a mediocre Lisp implementation, lots of problems, lots of flaws, but it survived after like 30 years or so. It might be worth like learning how to use it. It's quite simple. Emacs Lisp is like the support for Emacs Lisp is built in Emacs, even not FG42. As soon as you open up Emacs, you can start writing an eLisp code and extend Emacs with it. But to start with eLisp, the best thing I found is a mode called IELM, or I don't know, IELM or ILM, I don't know the pronunciation. I call it IELM, whatever, right? So, sorry. By executing this mode, you can see like a wrapper, right? eLisp wrapper. You can start typing some commands here and just run them. Another way to interact with eLisp is in any buffer. It doesn't matter what major mode are you using, like Python mode, Java mode, whatever, right? You can start writing some eLisp code and move to the final parentheses of the expression you're trying to execute or evaluate. Hit Control X, Control E, and as you can see in the mini buffer, I'll see the like return value of that expression, right? It's the easiest way to start evaluating some expressions. But let's talk about eLisp itself. So if you never have worked with Lisp is pretty simple. There's a couple of rules you have to know and you'll be good to go. The first rule is everything in Lisp has an evaluation, like most of other languages out there, right? So if I evaluate a number, it will evaluate to itself. As you can see in the mini buffer, the result is the same as the number. If I evaluate a string, it would be evaluated to itself. Same, right? If I evaluate a keyword, it would evaluate to itself, and vice versa for almost for 95% of data types in Lisp, the evaluation will return the same thing as the main data type, right? Beside three things actually. One is symbols, right? When I write down a symbol, right, and execute this one, I get a symbols value as variable is void, right? So when you eLisp is not an immutable functional programming language. It is not an immutable functional programming. So you have variables in this language. So basically, when you type a variable names, which we call them symbol name or symbol for short, when you execute it, eLisp try to find a variable or a function or whatever with that name and find the value of it, right, and return the value. We didn't define this variable right now, so when I execute it, I get this error, right? So in order to give it a value, I can say set Q ABC some number, and when I run it, evaluate it, I kind of assign ABC to value 1, 2, 3, right? So if I write ABC again, evaluate it as it is, I get 1, 2, 3 back, right? So it's how you create variables in general. So the first thing that doesn't evaluate to itself is symbol, right? The second thing is lists. Lists, like a linked list in computer science fashion, is a collection, is a sequence of some values, right? And to define a list, you have to start, like, surround the values with parentheses. So there's there should be a list function, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah. Right now, with function list, I created a list, as you see in the mini buffer, with two elements, 12 and another number, right? And another way of creating a list is just using parentheses, right? But if I evaluate this thing right now, I get an error saying that invalid function 2. So basically the way a Lisp, any Lisp works, is that in order to evaluate a list, it takes the first element, which in this case is number 2, as a function name or a special form name. You don't have to know what is a special form, just bear with me. And the rest of the parameters, rest of the elements, as the parameters for that function. So it tries to find, for this example, it tries to find the function that its name is 2, right? And when it found the function 2, it tried to call it with three parameters, 32, 23, and 4. But we don't have a function 2, so it raised an error. Okay, let's give you a better example. Right? Very simple expression. It's a list. The first element is plus, which is a function, right? So plus, which is in a function, 3, 4, 5, 6, as the rest of the list, which are going to be the parameters to that function. So when I execute it, I get 18 back, which is the sum of those numbers. It basically calls function plus with 3, 4, 5, 6 as its arguments. That's how lists are getting, like, that's how lists evaluate, right? eLisp is not an elegant language, so in other functional list programming languages, everything is in a function, but in Lisp, for example, plus is not a function, it's a built-in thing. Like, you can, usually people in Lisp would call them special forms, but it's not even a special form, right? What is a special form? A special form are some keywords, like, in compared to a language like Python, special forms are keywords like if, while, and stuff like that. The way they get evaluated is similar to lists, but with few differences, right? When I, for example, in functions, for functions, when I say like plus 4, 5, another parentheses, 2 times 4. And evaluate it. The way it works is eLisp first evaluate the inner parentheses, replace it with the result, and then call the plus function, right? But when I call if with, I don't know, something, PABC 1, 2, right? So the way if works here is, let me break it down so it would be easier for you to understand. If gets a like a conditional or a predicate or whatever, something to check for a true C value, right? If it was true, which in this case I'm checking if ABC is a symbol, right? If ABC is a variable, basically, right? If ABC is set, then return the it's a Lisp, right? It's a list, right? If it's the first element, conditional is the second one, the condition is the second one, and the third one is when the condition is true, and the fourth one is the basically the else class if the condition isn't true. So in this case it will return one. What? Return two actually. ABC is not a symbol. That's weird. Messed up. So you saw earlier that the condition was false, so it returned two. Now that it's correct, it's gonna return one. So the difference between a special form and a function is that if it was a function, basically this thing, for example, in this case, these two expression would have been evaluated first, and then if would have called with these parameters. But since if is a special form, it just evaluates this one and then decide which one to evaluate, right? It's a little bit different, but I guess you got it, and it doesn't matter after all. You know how if works. So there's other type of flow controls like while, loop, vice versa. You can take a look at eLisp documentations for those. They're not important. There's two more things you have to know. The first one is a lambda, right? You know what lambda is from other programming languages. When you type a lambda, by the way, that lambda sign is something we use in FG42, which called prettier symbols or something like that, which replaces the lambda or fn or function in different languages with the lambda sign. You don't have to type like the lambda sign, you just have to type lambda, right? When you type lambda, it should follows with the list of parameters. Right now we have no parameters and some other expression, right? So I created a function which doesn't take any argument and return 9, right? It always return 9. If I put it in a right, so if I call A, I messed it up, it doesn't work. I used the closure so much. So that's how you define a lambda, right? To call it, you have to call some functions in eLisp. It's not like closure or something that you can call it with parentheses. I forgot about that. Where do we use lambdas? Well, usually when we try to extend a hook, for example, when we try to execute some eLisp code while like Python mode, for example, gets evaluated. After Python mode, you want to run some code. You either have to define a function which contains those changes, or create a lambda with those changes, right? That's where we use lambdas. But the most important thing you have to know about eLisp is how to define a function. In order to define a function, we have to use defun, or how do you, I don't know how to pronounce it. This thing basically creates a function. You have to give it a name, a list of arguments, which let's say AB, and a Docker stream, right? eLisp is really strict about its style. Let's, for example, if I miss the Docker stream here, oh, we're in a scratch. If I move this thing to eLisp file, not here. I move it here, as you can see, it already warned me about some stuff. Like some stuff is missing in my function, in my file, in my eLisp file, which we can just follow the warnings and fix them. But one of them is like you need to add some Docker string. Let me show you something funny. And it is still complaining about my Docker stream. If you take a look at the comment section in mini buffer section, you'll see that it says ads should be add, right? It even parses your Docker stream and try to warn you, not warn you, like to give you tips of how to write a proper Docker stream, which I found really charming about eLisp, right? Another warning. It says B should be capital case. Now finally it left me alone. So with def on, we can define a function, right? When we evaluate this form, it's gonna define a function. Then in order to call it, as you already know, you have to use a list, right? ASADS D24, and it's gonna return 6, which is the output, right? Pretty easy. And this is basically the entire Lisp idea, how to evaluate, like everything has an evaluation, and basically the evaluation of lists are to find the function with the name that is specified by the first element and call it by passing the rest of the elements as the arguments to that function. This is it. By the stuff I just showed you, you can read any Lisp code, and especially eLisp code, right? But eLisp is more than a Lisp. Besides it being a Lisp, it has tons of functions and tons of functionality, which is heavily related to Emacs. For example, let me change the function name, it's so bizarre. ABC, right? When I define this function, the only place I can call this function is in eLisp itself. So if I, for example, move to IL and say ABC, you see, it's not there. I have to either require it. Oh, sorry. It is there, but I called it without a prompter, right? One thing you have to know about eLisp is that when you require something in one file, it would be accessible everywhere in that Emacs session, right? Just like what I did right now, I defined the function ABC in a different file. I evaluated the function definition, and then I can use it in IL as well. So it's kind of like, from programming perspective, it's a horrible thing to have, but you have to be aware of it, right? And basically, in FG42, in most places, I try to require a function even if I already required them in other files. There's no namespace, so the entire application is a giant namespace. If you require something in some file, you can access that in other files as long as that required expression evaluated before the code you're trying to evaluate. that's it. In order to move forward, there's another thing you have to know, which is like the code or single code character, I guess, right? Basically, what it does is to avoid the evaluation process. So when I say X, like single code X, and if I run it, I get X. So whatever that comes after the single code character, basically eLisp avoid the evaluation of that thing and return its that thing, right? So if I say 1, 2, 3, 4 as a list and prefix it by a single code, and when I evaluate it, I get the list 1, 2, 3, 4. So basically, as you already know, lists are evaluated. When you want to evaluate a list, you have to call the first element as a function, right? But when I put that single code character at the beginning, I'm telling Lisp to forget about the evaluation of this thing and just return it as it is. So the thing that you're seeing right now is another way of defining a list, basically, right? So I can do something like this. Message. By the way, message is kind of a print line in eLisp. You can print the stuff into message buffer. When I evaluate this thing, I get the exact list back. Sorry. But if I remove the single code, now eLisp is gonna evaluate this list and it's gonna print out the string, not returning the list, right? That single code, what else? Type evaluation function. Okay, there's lots of limitation about in eLisp. Basically, the multi-threading and multi-processing used to be really bad. Now there's libraries for it and a built-in multi-threading support, which is really good, but still in compared to other languages, like, I don't know, Clojure or JavaScript or whatever, it's not very good, but for an editor, it's quite amazing. What else? I guess that's it for the first one, which is like Lisp basics. One thing before I forget. So when I mentioned that eLisp has lots of stuff dedicated to Emacs and related to Emacs, which doesn't exist in any other programming languages, I'm going to show you a quick demonstration, right? So I have this function ABC right now, right? I evaluate it, I have the function. I can call it in any eLisp files I want, as long as it evaluated one, like the definition got evaluated at some stage. So, but in order to make it more interesting, I'm going to add this expression at the start of the function, reevaluate it. Now, if I hit Alt and X on a PC and search for ABC, you can see that it actually acts as a command in Emacs, right? So basically, in order to create a command in Emacs that you can access via the UI, you can add the expression interactive to at the beginning of your function. It has some parameters. I'm not going to bore you with the parameters. It's like there's a huge documentation about it. Sorry. There's a huge documentation about it, and like basically what it does is to create a command out of a function, right? You can, for example, you can change the parameters to that interactive expression to accept like a file name when you execute the command using Alt and X. There's a tons of stuff you can do, but that's one of the things that is good about eLisp. The language itself is not a great one, but the integration with Emacs is amazing. For example, you can, create buffers, get the current position, current buffer maybe. No, I don't remember the function name actually. Create current buff. No. To get help of any eLisp function, you can hit Control H, F, and type the name, or if you're on a function, it's gonna give you the documentation on that function, right? Buffer, for example, minimum buffer size, for example, right? You can see the documentation on the right hand side, and it's pretty straightforward to use it. Or for example, when you try the function, you can see the definition on the mini buffer. I guess that's enough for today. For this video, you like judging by the stuff I told you right now, I showed you right now, your knowledge, I'm pretty sure you're a programmer. When you're looking for something like this, you already have to know some programming languages and stuff like that. So judging by the stuff I showed you today and your previous skills, you should be able to read FG42 source code. It's at some places it's a little bit crazy. I'm going to go over those places in further videos, but in general you're going to have an easy time cruising through the code. And let me know if you have had any problems. You know where to find me.